So the future is going to look very much like a science fiction movie, like in Star Trek. You enter a holodeck, you can visit any world, visit alien creatures, interact with people from around the world in your private holodeck. And this is the core of the future. As we said before, transportation is the next big industry to be digitized. Artificial intelligence is good enough now so that your car can park itself and drive itself. So I say that in the future, the automobile industry will be eaten up by the robotics industry. I repeat, the robotics industry will be bigger than the automobile industry of today. How do we know that? Because in the future, your car will become a robot. You'll talk to your car. You'll argue with your car. You'll have great conversations with your car. Your car will recommend different places to go, identify sights as you see them. You'll treat your car like a companion, and no parking necessary. I live in New York City, where parking is almost impossible. So in the future, you simply talk to your wristwatch, call for the car, and then afterwards say, "Car, park yourself." The car parks itself, and afterwards you call for the car again with your wristwatch and say, "Car, come pick me up," and then park yourself again. In other words, things are going to change. Insurance rates could decrease because car accidents will become a thing of the past. And it also means that people may not want to own a car, because when you need a car, you simply call for it on your wristwatch. You may want to lease a car instead. So our car will become part of this great digital world, and the industry, the car industry, will be eaten up by the robotics industry. Millions of people will be employed to design, repair, modify, take care of robots. And not just cars, but cars will fly. Yes, cars can fly. It turns out they're kind of expensive, but next month I'm speaking in Dubai, where Uber has already signed the contract to put into process cars that fly. Not only that, but you will be able to go supersonic in commercial transport. Now, this means that you'll be able to have breakfast in New York, lunch in Tokyo, and dinner back in New York again. How's that possible? Well, we had the Concorde. Remember the Concorde? Supersonic transport. Go to London in 3 hours. Well, there was a problem with that. The sonic boom. The sonic boom shattered windows everywhere the Concorde went, because the Concorde used 1960 technology to design the wings. Think about that, 1960 technology to design the airflow over the wings. No wonder it created a sonic boom. Today, we have supercomputers. Your cell phone today has more computer power than all of NASA in 1969 when they put two men on the moon. Think about that. Your cell phone has more computer power than all the great pentagons and nations of the world in 1969. In fact, it was criminal the way NASA was sending humans into outer space backed up by one cell phone. But that's what they did back in the 1960s. Now we have supercomputers that can model supersonic airflow and reduce the sonic boom so that you'll be able to travel around the world in just a few hours. And then beyond that, we're going to go to the moon and on to Mars. As I said, we physicists are the ones who created the space program. Wernher von Braun, for example, was a PhD, had a PhD in physics. We're going back to the moon starting next year. In December of 2019, the SLS booster rocket is scheduled to shoot an unmanned space probe around the moon. And we're going to have a new rocket being built by Elon Musk to take us to Mars. This new rocket has been recently named. This huge rocket to take us to the moon and to Mars is called the BFR. B for big, R for rocket, and F for your imagination.